Hello and welcome to the first lecture of Traffic Flow Dynamics and Simulation, a master's course. Before we go into the center, I will first give some administrative details. And for this, it's best to look at my website, at the lecture's website. So let's just open it. So it's available, can be reached from the normal chairs website. It's also mtreiber.de slash vkmod, which comes from a German Verkehrsmodellierung. Okay, here you see first some news. For example, that this is only in the summer semester. And here's also the first lecture slides are online. In particular, the first lecture slide, which we will today teach in the videos, is online, so you can also look at it via the website. Also, notice that this lecture, up to 2019, has been held in German. So we have also a number of German slides. However, the German slides are not updated, so they may not cover the whole lecture, all the contents. And particularly later on, I have also some new material which is not covered in this 2019 German lecture slides. So let's look what's also on this website. Go above again. Of course, we have, as usual, we have lectures and tutorials. However, due to this Corona situation, which by the way can also be simulated here, I have coronasimulation.de, so we will also, here you can interactively model some dynamics, but that's just if you are interested. At least the simulation shows that it will go a little bit up to 200 and then it will go down. Let's hope that this is correct. But anyway, we will hold this lecture purely online. There's no presence. And it seems that also the exercises will be held in an electronic format. So, everything is available online. The slides we showed already. There are also the first tutorials. So the first problems. Now it's only in German, but I'm about to compose the first English-speaking tutorial. At least the first tutorials are the same in English and German, so you can use either. So let's go back to the course homepage. So we have slides, we have tutorials with problems and solutions. Solutions will appear once the week for the tutorial is over. And there are also videos. The first one you will just about to hear. And I will prepare a YouTube channel for these lectures. And there's not yet active. But once they're active, you can get all the lectures from this channel. And also for the tutorials, I will also add, maybe not all tutorials, but most of them are also added to the same video channel. And of course, if everybody still does not know, my name is Martin Treiber. So I give both the courses and the tutorials. Regarding the references, basically they are only my two textbooks. There's not no real other book covering the whole topic. Of course, there are parts of the topic are covered elsewhere, but basically everything is in these books. This is an updated version of the German book. So this is German, this is English. You could use either of them. And they are also available at the SLAPF. And you can also buy them the Springer Press at a discount. And of course, you will get for each bought book, you will get one additional point at the exam. Just go joking, of course. So let's go into the subject. What is traffic dynamics, or more precisely, traffic flow dynamics about? It's all about, as the name says, traffic flow. It's not only vehicular car flow, but it may also concern pedestrians or the bicycle flow. It may even concern such as cross-country ski, but these are special topics. Let's start just with a normal car vehicular flow. And in order to get something useful out of it, we need first data. So the first lecture will be about traffic flow data and which kind of data are useful for the for our investigation. First are the trajectory and floating car data. These are from the car itself, taken from the car itself, from the floating car. Then there are external trajectory data from outside, and the floating car data also have a variant, extended floating car data, which not only record the normal GPS position, but also other aspects, other dynamic variables. So we will come to that. So first, what is traffic flow dynamics about? Basically, traffic flow dynamics describes the interplay between many vehicles and their drivers, sometimes technically also called driver-vehicle units, and of course the interaction with the infrastructure. So what is the schematic flow diagram? Of course, there are some fundamentals of traffic flow. Then there's of course some mathematics, because as in econometric modeling, I use quantitative mathematical models for to describe everything. And then of course these other data, which is the subject of our present lecture. With these together, you get the models, mathematical models, and of course from the data and the math you get empirical effects. Basically, this is pretty much the same as in econometrics, where you also have data, you have mathematics, and you have theory, only that the theory in this time is economic theory, macro and microeconomics and so. But basically the flow diagram is the same. And once you have the models that also have some empirical effects, then first you need to fit the model to the data, because a model only gives a structure, for example, whether a car follows another car and which variables it uses, and the empirical effects gives which way it follows, for example, the time gap, the accelerations, and so on. And once you have fixed your model, you need also to test it using other data, if it also can predict things well, or if it's just useless, just an overfit. So the tools are mathematical models, sets of equations. The methods are of course the simulation, because the mathematical models are basically sufficiently complicated that you cannot solve it analytically. So what are the main use cases? Of course, you can do just traffic state recognition and detection. That gives you jam warning systems and dynamic navigation. Then you can use traffic flow modeling to generate surrounding traffic for traffic simulators, both for game simulators, but moreover for scientific simulations for driving psychology. And then, of course, you can optimize traffic flow in many aspects. New infrastructure controls, new technologies, ACC, which will do infrastructure communications, assist assistance system, and ultimately autonomous vehicles. We need to eliminate the traffic flow dynamics or traffic dynamics from other fields. Here I have just a list with time scales. This time scale goes to the subject of vehicle dynamics. Vehicle dynamics, such as control and engines and brakes, in difference to traffic dynamics. So vehicle is just a single vehicle, and of course such things as an electronic stability program, ESP, and everything needs actions in the sub-second, in the millisecond regime. This could be sub-microscopic models, which is not the topic of our lecture, but of vehicle dynamics. There are other chairs doing vehicle dynamics. Then are the typical, the domain of the traffic flow dynamics. That is, goes from 1 second, which for example, reaction time, the time gap of one driver follows another. 10 seconds is the typical acceleration and deceleration time. 1 minute is the typical period phase of traffic lights, and 10 minutes is the typical period of stop and go waves. And also 1 hour, maybe even, it's the typical time scale of traffic breakdown and dissolution of traffic jams. However, everything which is above is the domain of transportation planning, such as route assignment and traffic demand modeling. Basically here, we take the traffic demand and also in most cases the route, but not always, but it is the traffic demand as given, and look how the traffic demand flows operatively through the networks. And transportation planning mainly deals with demand modeling, and it has also a supply modeling, but that's the most simple, the so-called traffic stream models. We will come to that later on. In summary, we have a delimitation from transportational planning, and also with a delimitation from the vehicular dynamics. Transportation planning is this field, and vehicular dynamics is this above field. So in the following, we will just look at this region, at this center region of traffic flow dynamics. So let's just take a closer look at the different kinds of traffic flow data, because without these, we will operate in empty space and we will have no feedback to reality. And because we are not doing philosophy, but more sort of down-to-earth science, we need data. So the first and the easiest, the most intuitive type of data are the trajectory data. Trajectory data are just a full set of the positions x and y. Typically I define x to be in the longitudinal direction and y to be in the lateral position, and t the time. And typically it's a coverage of all the vehicles in a certain spatiotemporal region. And because of this, you typically need an external camera. This camera can be mounted on a high building, a bridge and so on, but nowadays the most mount points are drones, that means unmanned aerial vehicles. These may seem wobbly, but they have so perfect stabilizing mechanism that basically such a drone with a camera well stabilized is just as if it is nailed just down to the sky, up to the, in the sky. And it can be very well used to take such trajectory data. Another thought which is becoming increasingly relevant are the floating car data. While to date trajectory data are still more for researchers and for experimental setting, the floating car data are used worldwide. They can really be drastically scaled up, because basically every modern vehicle has a GPS navigation system anyway, and if you communicate the GPS positions to some central data center, you have floating car data, and you can do all sorts of them with this data, which we will learn in this a lecture. A special case are extended floating car data. They have not only the GPS records, but also other inside vehicle sensors. For example, the position of the steering wheel, the position of the throttle, of the braking pedal. All this can be included in extended floating car data. Moreover, if this car has an adaptive cruise control, then you have also some ranging system, distance to a front vehicle, to a leader, and this is included as well. Basically, every data which is available on the vehicle's data bus, which is the CAN bus, which all modern vehicles have, it can be tapped, and from this CAN bus, data can be recorded. But still, the workhorse nowadays are still the cross-sectional data. They are typically either buried into the road or mounted on bridges, and they just count data. We will come to that in the next lecture, O2. And finally, there was event-oriented data such as accident information or traffic jam information. And of course, we need also infrastructure data, the road network, the speed limits, the number of lanes, if there are traffic lights, the traffic light phases, and all that. So here you see the first, the classical trajectory data set of Dreiter et al. Recorded in the 1970s. Although it's the first of its kind, it already has all the features. Basically, I always have a convention that the time is on the horizontal axis from left to right, and cars or other vehicles go upwards on the vertical axis in this direction. That means the faster a vehicle is, the steeper the trajectories here are. So obviously here, trajectories are vehicles are driving, and here vehicles are quite slow. You also see that there are some trajectories begin and end. That's because there's only one a lane is here recorded, and if it's begin, it's just a lane change from another lane from the left or from the right, and here the vehicle changes again. So if you look carefully, you'll see some of them here. Here's one. And what you also see, and that's quite interesting, is a sort of a collective movement. This dark shade, it's no, I just record. It seems to move against the driving directions. So the trajectory is going this direction, and this whole object moves against. What is this? This is in fact a traffic wave. And interestingly, we will look at this in more detail later on. The traffic waves, all waves go against the driving direction. Maybe I also show it on the my internet driving simulator. Let's just go to the browser, and here you see interactive traffic simulator. Here I will go to the simple scenario, the ring scenario, and it's just a ring, so you see a longer distance. And after some time, maybe I just stop some vehicle, introduce some perturbation. You see where the traffic wave builds up. And now the traffic wave has formed. And you see that the traffic wave goes opposite in the opposite direction of the vehicles. And that's the typical characteristics of a traffic wave. So we will come to that traffic flow instability and traffic wave formation later on. So that's the first time you see it in action. You can also simulate by yourself, traffic-simulation.de. So there are several scenarios. But now back to the trajectories. So let's do some task with the trajectories. For this, I have selected two small regions, and in order to look what's inside this region, how you can analyze it, I have a zoom for this section, and now we can analyze it. First, we should estimate the local density at the center. At the center, that's the center time, and that's the center x, and by trajectory counting. So let's first do the density. Density is by definition the number of vehicles per distance for a given time. And it's easiest to count the number either on the left edge or on the right edge, anywhere where you have a fixed time, that means a fixed horizontal coordinate. Maybe let's do it first left. So that's the one. Maybe I choose another color. Yes, this is better. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Let's say 16. 16 to the left. And of course, there's always a counting uncertainty, a discrete uncertainty, and we could also do it in the middle, but let's do it because here it's hard to get a vertical line. Let's just do it here and look what happens here. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So here we have 12. So you see it's also it depends on where you are, but that's always the problem with local quantities. Of course, they change slightly when going in space or time. So that's also in order to define local quantity, you need a sufficiently a large region that you have several trajectories, but it needs to be sufficiently small that no distinct changes take place. Particularly if you go back, you see it's no big changes take place. You could not extend the region, for example, to this, because then it would make no sense to define or to determine local density. So we had 12 and 16. Let's look what here we had 15 plus 13, but that's basically the same. The distance was 200 meters, so we have on average 14 vehicles divided by 2 per 100 meters, 7 per 100 meters, and 70 per kilometer. So that was our local density, 70 vehicles per kilometer. That's a quite high density that corresponds to congested traffic. You can also see, if you look closely, that it really is congested traffic by looking that there are small structures going in this direction, sort of wave-like. And whenever traffic waves, that means local perturbations, go against the traffic direction, then we have congested traffic. So now let's go further. estimate the local flow. Again, by counting. Basically, we do the same, only this time we need the definition of the flow. That means for a given location, just the number of vehicles per time unit. So let's do it again at the edges, this time the horizontal edges. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Here's 1, 10, 11, 12, 13. So that means here we have 13. And then we do the same above. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Here we had 14. So here we had 13 plus 14 here, and here in the template solution it was 11 plus 14. So as always, you can miscount by one or two. That doesn't matter. If you have a problem in an examination and a miscount by one, that's no problem. Let's use these numbers. That means on average we have 12.5 per 30 seconds, because this region was from 0 seconds, 0 was here, 30 seconds here. And if you do the math and multiply, so we have 25 vehicles per minute, and if you multiply this by 60, then we get the vehicles per hour. So finally, how to estimate the local speed? There are two possibilities. First, you can use the gradient method. For the gradient method, you just use the average gradient for any trajectory. Let's just select a trajectory. Let's use this. So this maybe starts here, so it's just this trajectory. So it has about, it has, let's say 28 seconds, because it crosses the boundary here. Let's say it goes here. So we had the horizontal was a time, so it was 28. And what distance does this vehicle cover in this time? This distance. This distance would be 200 meters. So let's maybe say it's 180 meters. So let's just do the math. We had recorded 180 meters here, from here to here, and in a time from here to here, 28 seconds, and that's about 6.5 meters per second, about 23 kilometers per hour. So that was the local speed by the gradient method. Just the average gradient of the trajectory. Now the hydrodynamic relation. That's, we will also look in detail later on. The speed is equal to traffic flow divided by density. This derived from the traffic flow is just the local speed times the density. That's also like in rivers, where the flow is just the water per second, and that is proportional to the speed, and also it's proportional to the density. The density in flows in rivers would be just the cross section, because unlike traffic, water is essentially incompressible. So basically, if we do the math here, we have 1,500 vehicles per hour in the numerator, and 70 vehicles per kilometer, which we calculated as densities in the denominator, and that gives about 21 kilometers. So we see it's quite consistent with the one method we had 33 kilometers per hour, with the other 23 and 21 kilometer per hour. And allowed by the counting errors, if you count, miscount one, and sometimes it's difficult to look at the corners. Basically, if when counting vehicles, you have two trajectories at the corners, then count only one, because otherwise you do count one too many, because if you count this at the corner, then this at the corner would correspond to the next region up there. But as I said, with such estimations, nobody will detract, subtract any points if examination such thing comes up and you miscount by one point. So both answers are completely plausible and completely okay. So now let's, we have calculated essentially the red thing, the congested area here. Now we go over to the green area, and obviously the trajectories are steeper, and we expect that the density is smaller and the speed is higher. So let's just do it. So let's again magnify the green region. First, the local density. Remember how to define it. Density is number of vehicles per space. So that means we need the vertical edges. To the left, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8. And here we have a problem with the two trajectories. This does not count only this, because we have counted this edge trajectory. So we have 8. 8 plus 10. Again, divided by 200 meters, because this is 200 meters. That gives 45 vehicles per kilometer. Now the local flow. Again, that's the number per time unit. By the way, it's at least for me, this is interesting. This is a sort of visual distortion, just the deception of the eye. It seems that these are not connected, but they are. So we can just count again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. And this does not count, because we have counted this, so 15. And here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 13, 4, 5, 6, 17. So 15 and 17. Here we have 14 plus 16, but this gives basically the same. So we have 15 per vehicles per 30 seconds, 30 vehicles per minute, and multiply by 60, we have 1,800 vehicles per hour. So it's quite a speed which is not yet completely free. It's dense traffic, and it's no freeway. It's a sort of city aerial material. So this is plausible. So we have a lower density, and the flow is even a little bit higher. Again, the local speed by two methods. For the gradient, maybe we take the trajectory which is here. Just draw it so it's it goes here. So that means we have this is 200 meters, and now we have to estimate the time. The total time here is 30 seconds, so this is a little bit more than a half, maybe 80 seconds, 18 seconds. So we have 200 meters divided by 18 seconds. That's about 11 meter per seconds, and 11 meter, that's 39.6 kilometer per hour. It's about this 10% different from this, but as I said, the counting errors, it's completely consistent. So let's look what Yes, here I did the same, 200 divided by 18, about 11, and that's about 40 kilometer power. Now, the hydrodynamic relation, we just do the division, last data divided by 45. Here, interestingly, also arrive at 40 kilometer power, but that's by chance. Typically, you have some small mismatch because of all the counting errors. So let's how trajectories are analyzed. So here's I have some other problem. First, you have just to see what could be displayed here. Again, time horizontal, position vertical. Here steep trajectories, a faster traffic. It also seems that vehicles are much faster here. A first check for this trajectory, for example, in the first 10 seconds, it has covered again 100 meters, 10 meters. So it's again about 11 meter per seconds. So it's not so fast. Or probably it's also city traffic. It's just another time scale, which is less than seems deeper. But here we have a real traffic wave. So let's do the, so it's so the situation is a traffic wave. Now the propagation velocity of the stop and go wave. How to do this? Now here we have to find let's say the edges of this structure. Let's see, here's an edge. Let's do it, for example, like this. And so this is the spatial temporal region where vehicles dive into the traffic wave, and here they leave the traffic wave. And then again, we can, as at the calculate the trajectory speed, we can also calculate the collect the speed of this traffic wave. Maybe we just so another color. So maybe it's here we have 150 meters. So that's the vertical is 150 meters. So and the so that's the distance, and the time is from here to here. So this is 20, so roughly it's a little bit more than 20. Let's say 25 seconds. So we have, and of course the gradient is negative. That means it's a negative velocity. By the way, velocity is a vectorial speed, and if we have a sign, it means although it's one dimensional, speed can point upwards and downwards. So I call this a velocity, while the trajectory of the vehicles only can dive along the road direction. I call it a speed. So we have here a propagation velocity of minus 25 seconds of minus 150 meter divided by 25 seconds. That is, you can simplify, that is minus 6 meter per second. And if you multiply with 3.6, you get the velocity in kilometer per hour. 6 times 3.6 is 21.6. So we have minus 21.6 kilometer per hour. So let's see what I calculated here. It's only the question. So it's about minus 21 kilometer per hour. And interestingly, this is nearly a traffic constant. The propagation velocity of traffic wave, or fully developed traffic waves, is between minus 15 kilometers per hour and minus 22 kilometer per hour. So this velocity is at the upper negative end. So now a final question. What microscopic situation could be shown at 70 seconds and x equal 40 meters? So what can be seen here? 70, it's going up a cup here. And here we have 40. So obviously this is a jacket is suddenly appearing and here suddenly disappearing. So that's again a lane change to the lane 2. From any other lane, it cannot be seen from this trajectory from which lane. So from lane 1 or 1-3, the car went to lane 2. And here again, did another lane change and vanishes from lane 2. So a final problem. First, which situation could be displayed here? Again, you remember horizontal is always a time and vertical always the distance, and vehicles per convention always drive in the positive x direction. So obviously here you have smoothly traffic flow, and here suddenly some obstacle appears so that these vehicles here all stop. And now here that obstacle vanishes and vehicles accelerate and have the free flow speed again. So which situation could be displayed here? Which obstacle appears and vanishes suddenly, stopping the vehicles? That's of course a traffic light. So this represents a traffic light. So this black bar is the phase where the traffic light at position x equals 0 is red. And then of course this vehicle stop. And this is not a dynamic traffic wave, but it's just a queue. It's just a queued vehicle queue behind the red traffic light. And here the light gets green, vehicles accelerate. And here you see that you also recognized often. Here, for example, let's say you are this orange vehicle. Traffic light green, traffic light green, traffic light green, traffic light green. And still you cannot move. Only when the wave front reaches you and you can start. And here you also see this has nothing to do with reaction time, because all the way it's more than 10 seconds you see that the thing is green. It has to do that standing traffic has leads less space than moving traffic. And that we want to analyze now. So this is first the traffic light. Let's now calculate the braking acceleration distances. That's just here I've visualized the where the deceleration maneuver starts and the here where the acceleration maneuver ends. Then of course the distance. Let's for example just do this vehicle, because here the start is at 40 meters, and here it has fully stopped. So it's maybe 25 meters from minus 40 to minus 15. Meters. So this is the deceleration would be maybe 25 or maybe yes, between 25 and 30. Now the acceleration, let's just do this vehicle, because here this is just only 40. So here it starts accelerating and here it ends accelerating, and this would be 40 and it's a little bit more. It's maybe 50 meters. So the deceleration is 25 meters and the acceleration is 50 meters. So obviously the deceleration acceleration itself differs by a factor of 2. That's also your answers, 25 and 50 meters. So now the next question, calculate the minimum braking deceleration and acceleration needed during these maneuvers. The minimum means, of course, if you hardly brake at the beginning, then you need to brake harder still the end. Otherwise, you cannot do the braking distance of 25 meters. Here you need to just use the school formula of calculating from a parabola. That's just the breaking distance is just v squared divided by 2 times the breaking deceleration. And the acceleration distance is the same, only that that's the phi final squared divided by 2 times the acceleration. You know the distance because we've just calculated. So you know the, you know, it's still not know, but you can easily calculate the final speed. Let's just do the final speed first. That's maybe here, that's these are all parallel, so we can just use this for the free flow speed. Also, before the deceleration and after the acceleration, the speed is the same. So let's just use this. Here we have 0, 0, and here we have 100 meters and 10 seconds. So 100 meter divided by 10 seconds is 36, is 10 meter per second. It means we can now insert a formula, v squared divided by 2 times the distance. V squared is 100 meter squared divided by second squared divided by 2s by 50 is 2 meter per second squared. Notice that when always when doing computer calculations or such kinematic calculations, always use SI units, that means meter, seconds, and kilogram. For the informal units, such as kilometer per hours, that's only for displaying. But do all calculations, and particularly all computer calculations, all simulations, always use SI units. 100 million satellites have been lost because the rocket booster uses SI units to calculate to control it, while the navigation system determining the orbit uses feet and such stuff. And this mismatch, of course, resulted in a wrong orbit, so the scientific mission of this satellite was lost. Only because the people did not use consistent units. And for this, SI units, meter, kilogram, and seconds are king. So the same with acceleration, because the acceleration distance is double, the acceleration is half, so it's only 1 meter per second squared. Okay, the velocity we have already calculated, it's 10 meter per second. Okay, I see we need the velocity of the upstream and downstream of the queue. And of course we can calculate again just by connecting these points. Let's for example start with this. At zero, this is by, at about minus 30 meters, and if it's 35 seconds, it's at minus 80 meters, so it has minus 50 meters divided by 36 seconds, or here minus 40 meters divided by 30 seconds, that's minus 1.3 meter per seconds, or minus 4.8 kilometer per hour. And the downstream, downstream that means where the jam ends, the graphic queue ends, with the same calculation, it's minus 11.5 kilometer per hour. By the way, this speed, this is no simulation, it's just drawn, and here the speed is too slow, because this should be the same speed as the jam wave propagation velocity. That means it should be at least minus 15 kilometers, not just minus 11.5 kilometer per hour. This was the trajectory problem. Now let's go over to floating cars. So that's what floating CAR data look like. That's I got this from the TomTom Traffic Center. At first sight, it looks exactly like the trajectories. So we have this this obvious free traffic, vehicles, floating cars going upstream, and this is the traffic wave. And here you see all these fine and coarse structures are nearly parallel. And that's of course because the traffic wave is always this already known universal speed. We will now calculate it. But first, what is the difference? Or first, how are floating cars data recorded? Whenever you use a navigation, a satellite navigation system, and also use the traffic dependent navigation, which is called live traffic at TomTom, or on Google Maps, it's automatic by default. And of course, Google Maps, for example, gives you all this information for free, seemingly for free. You pay with your data, because in an anonymous form, Google, or here the TomTom data center, gets your data, and they can record it in their traffic center and analyze it and give you right recommendations. It seems rather dense, but in fact, unlike the trajectory data taken by drone or other drone-based or other fixed camera settings, they are very incomplete. Only about 2 to 4 of at most 5% of all cars have an active navigation satellite system of the same brand, for example, Google Maps or TomTom. And still, because this is a freeway and there's a lot of traffic, there's enough traffic that you all see all the macroscopic features. Let's just try if we can estimate first the propagation velocity of the traffic wave, and second, how much a typical driver is delayed by this wave structure when going covering all this distance. So first, the propagation velocity. So we just take the biggest one because it's the easiest to calculate. So it just goes from here to here. So we can just again. So that's about from here to here. It's about 2 hours. And the kilometers are 49 for 30 kilometers. So we have, and of course negative because it's downstream. So we have minus 30 kilometers per 2 hours. That means minus 15 kilometer per hour is the propagation velocity of this traffic wave. So now let's look at the time delay. For this, we compare just the travel time without any delay with the travel time when driving through the jams. Let's first look at the reference. Maybe just look here. Here's nearly free traffic. Just get this trajectory. And here you see in free traffic, it just takes maybe 20 minutes to cover this a 30 kilometer distance. That means 90 kilometer per hour. So it's still dense traffic. So it's you cannot drive at say 150 kilometer per hour. But it's just a reference. So without any jams, you would take 20 minutes. Let's look at the delay with jams. That of course depends on the The starting situation. Let's just look list trajectory here, maybe here. Here it goes here. Yeah, then here again, this one. So we are here. So and then we just compare. That's about this time. And here you see this is an hour. This is a little bit more than an hour. That's maybe 1 hour 20. That means if you start here at this if you enter this situation here, then you lose a full hour because you need 1:20 instead of 20. That's also watch out if you look if you hear such delays from Google Map or even from the radio. It's only the delay. That means here the delay is 1 hour. Still, you drive 1 hour 20 minutes through the jam. Often the difference is even less. That means the jam only doubles the time. That means the delay in this test is only half the time you go through the jam. That's always take into account if obeying this traffic information. So you see, with this floating car data, you can do a lot. Particularly, you can, because it's just in the trajectories, you can directly estimate the travel time. And that's why this floating car data are so useful for navigation, because navigation is just based on travel time. So let's look into floating car data in more detail. And just the difference between trajectory and floating car data. First, of course, the data source, stationary versus mobile. You can also say the trajectory data is out of the system versus the floating car data is in the system. Then the scalability. The trajectory data, you need special cameras, drone-based or fixed-point based. It's very small spatial-temporal regions. Typically, you can only cover about 400 meters with a single camera, a drone-based camera. In contrast, floating cars is scalable worldwide because everybody nowadays has a satellite navigation, so it's huge. That of course means all the scalability is non-existent versus huge. Now the completeness. Trajectory data has 100% because it's just recorded by camera and then trajectory is extracted. However, the floating car data, the penetration rate, the sampling is small and it's unknown. The penetration rate is about a few percent, but it's not only small, it's unknown. That means many things, for example, traffic flows, all things which are so-called extensive quantities, we will come to that, cannot be estimated by floating car data because there you would need the penetration rate. However, intensive quantities such as speed or travel time, they do not go proportional to the number of vehicles that can be estimated perfectly. Computational requirement is huge because you need to extract trajectories from the cameras in case of trajectories, and it's small, just record the GPS recordings from the for floating cars. Precision. It depends for trajectories on the pixel size, and for floating cars, it depends on the satellite navigation uncertainty. It's about 10 meters. Depends how many satellite systems, GLONASS, Galileo, GPS, and there's also a Chinese one are used. Sampling frequency, typically every 100 meters is the frequency for trajectory data. Or even if you have the movie sequence 30 frames per second, when you if you have 30 milliseconds, however, because of bandwidth, so Google Maps and others need to use a mobile phone or other communication devices, data are sent only every few or even maybe every 30 seconds. So the sampling frequency is not very high. So now finally some problems. Discuss suitable applications for trajectory and floating car data. Consider possible applications are navigation systems, model development, model calibration, validation, autonomous driving. So first for navigation, as I said, travel times can be defined perfectly. Precision is enough, so floating car data. Assistance system, there are some applications where floating car data are enough. For example, traffic jam warnings. For others, adaptive cruise control, you need local, you need extended floating car data. Interestingly, we have in the floating car data context what I call an anti-Murphy's law. The Murphy's law states what can go wrong will go wrong. For example, if you lose a screw when repairing something, this screw will first destroy sensible parts of an engine and then roll into the most remote corner where you cannot get it. So that was more of Murphy's law. Here we have anti-Murphy because the information, the needed information is just there at high density if you need it. You need it if there are jams or other events, and then jams needs, of course, by definition, many vehicles, and that means even if you have a low penetration rate, you have a high number of recording vehicles and you get a good information. Good information exactly when you need it. So navigation is floating car assistance system. Both are useful, and for some assistant, its extended floating cars are mandatory. Model development. You would like first trajectory data in order to get a complete fleet, a complete sampling. But for some applications, for example, for calibrating car following models, car following is nothing else as what a floating car does if it also has a range sensor for this extended floating car data are good. Most demanding is, of course, autonomous driving. Neither ex-floating car data nor trajectory data is enough. You need everything, high precision navigation, moreover high precision digital maps, and very sophisticated, say extended floating car data, camera-based, and interpretation of objects in situ. So that is the future. So finally, a fun fact, there are not only car trajectory data and car floating car data, but also for pedestrians. For example, maybe some of you know the Strava. Strava is an application for smartwatches, sportwatches, and where you can record and your running, cycling, swimming, climbing, hiking, or whatever, cross-country skiing effects. It's a social network, a Facebook for sports. And it has a functionality called heat map. There also anonymously all recorded tracks are drawn on the static map, and the more runners use this track, the hotter this trajectory, this road becomes. So, brown or red is rarely used, orange is often used, and it's white glowing when it's very often used. For example, here that's by the way Dresden, that is the Große Garten, and here that's the Schloss. And so this 500 meter course here is very often used. Finally, we mentioned it already, extended floating car data. As the name implies, it's not just floating car data, that means just recorded satellite navigation data. That means also trajectories, but not complete trajectories, but only for the equipped cars. But additional extended floating car data are augmented by additional information by the vehicle sensors and the internal vehicle data bus, the CAN bus. Most important of these is the range sensor needed for autonomous vehicles and also adaptive cruise control, which tracks and detects range as the leading vehicle, or more generally, the object which is in front of the front radar or LiDAR sensor. And that's, for example, and you can also record the gap to the leading vehicle. Not only the speed can be derived from the GPS data, but if you have also a gap and also the internal speed data from the data bus, then it's much more precise than as if you need to derive, in the literal sense, the speed from the GPS data. What could be read off the vehicle's CAN bus? First, of course, as I said, directly the speed and the speedometer reading. These are different. Sometimes speed is basically the actual physical speed or the rotation of the wheels, and speedometer is what the speedometer reads. Typically, this is a little bit higher. Then, of course, throttle or braking pedal pressure, the steering angle, and all sorts of switches, lights, fingers, heating, whatever. And if you have a range sensor, the distance gap to the leader or to other objects, then you can calculate from it the relative speed to a leader, or some range sensors even calculate it directly via the Doppler effect. And some also, if it's an ACC controller in the car, then also the desired deceleration by the ACC controller is also can be read off the vehicle's CAN bus. This was the first lecture of traffic dynamics and simulation for master's course. First, we defined what is the subject all about, what is traffic flow dynamics, and then we looked into detail on trajectory data and floating car data. In the next lesson 2, we will look into more detail at stationary detector data. Many thanks.